Resistance Literature, A Community of Voices in the Break. Polyphony.
A mouthful I know, but I love the word. Its etymology is Greek, and it refers to many sounds. As a sole parent of three children and a dog, I'm all too familiar with hearing many sounds at once. I've become conversant in texting, teenager, black, and buster, the linguistic code of my canine companion. I first became familiar with polyphonic voices in literature in the 80s and 90s after finishing a bachelor's degree in English literature. I had read hordes of books by dead white guys. Now don't get me wrong, some of my best friends are dead white guys. I wanted to hear new voices. I discovered I had a distinct preference for novels with many voices, The Temple of My Familiar, Fall on Your Knees, A Fine Balance, and The Bone People are among my favorites. I love a good yarn about fucked up people. What struck me the most about these stories is the way the multiple characters come together to form a sense of family and community and gain strength from each other while facing seemingly insurmountable challenges. I also gravitated toward films with intersecting storylines, multiple story arcs that do not privilege goals of single characters. Magnolia, Things You Can Tell by Just Looking at Her, Amelie, and Talk to Me. These films are about marginalized or eccentric people and suggest that things happen for a reason, that the actions of one have a ripple effect on all. With polyphony is the possibility that a story, a work of literature, does not need to have a hero. Sorry, Black Panther. What if there are no heroes? Multiple narrators problematize the notion of a single protagonist. That changes the way we view characters within a story. What if we're all in this together? What if it doesn't matter whether a single individual overcomes obstacles to reach a personal goal? What if the actions of one impact the actions of all? What if? Katarina Vermette artfully develops intertwining voices in The Break. Likewise, Juno Diaz crafts a polyphonic novel in The Brief Wondrous Life of Oscar Wilde. Both writers place their characters in media res, into the throes of colonialism and the legacy of intergenerational trauma. In Vermette's tale, an adolescent girl is sexually assaulted and her family rushes to her hospital bedside, including her mother, aunt, grandmother, and great-grandmother. Her grandmother, Cheryl, observes, "Wolves teach humility. They teach that we are all in this together, all a part of the same whole. If something happens to one of them, they all feel it." Emily shifts from being a girl with a high school crush to becoming the victim of a violent crime overnight. The violence she experiences impacts all those around her. Diaz playfully writes about the legacy of colonialism on the Dominican diaspora by referring to colonialism as a curse, a fuku, or fuku americanus. He states that everyone is impacted by the fuku, even if they don't know about it. He refers to the onset of colonialism as being brought about by the Admiral, his moniker for Christopher Columbus, and assures us that since the Admiral's arrival, we've all been in the shit ever since. Diaz's multi-generational saga is also populated with scenes of horrific violence. Intertextuality is a feature of polyphonic writing. Vermette's polyphonic novel can be placed in the category of community-based writing. I call it the kith and kin genre. It is also a feminist text. The novel is prefaced with a quotation from Marilyn Dumont's poem, Helen Betty Osborne, another quotation from Alice Walker, and it is followed by acknowledgments that pay particular respect to community workers. This book is an offering of gratitude to the community workers and helpers who save the world in a million little ways every day, writes Vermette. Many of the characters in the book try to make their communities a better place. The book concludes with a brief bio of the writer in which she positions herself as a Métis writer from Treaty 1 territory. Through the voices of Vermette's 10 narrators, one a spirit, one a male, two in first person, and three from youth, the reader gets a sense of many Métis voices with different backgrounds and experiences and how these characters relate to each other and navigate their world on the lands in which they live. The images that grace the cover of The Break are those of Métis artist Karina Michelle Wolf. She notes in her thesis exhibition statement, The Métis, as an Indigenous people in Canada, have a group-oriented rather than individualistic culture. Therefore, their worldview is spoken about as shared. At the end of the break, there is no grand finale. The impact of colonialism is still felt. The novel ends with the characters continuing to care for each other as they had before, but with a shift in how they see themselves and each other. The quotation from Dumont's poem references the violent rape and murder of a young Cree woman, Helen Betty Osborne, who was abducted in Manitoba in 1971 by four white males, brutally assaulted and killed. Only one perpetrator was convicted, and only after 16 years. Beatrice Monsonnier includes a similar act of violence in her novel, In Search of April Raintree. One of the two protagonists, April Raintree, is abducted by four white men and sexually assaulted in a car. Monsonnier is mentioned in Vermette's acknowledgments. The character Lorraine in The Break is nicknamed Rain. These Métis women, writers, thinkers, and artists call and respond. They reference each other and each other's works that bring the issue of missing and murdered Indigenous women and girls to the forefront. As well as seeing The Break as a piece of community-based writing, I see it as an example of a counter-narrative, as resistance literature. In Vermette's text, as Stella gets older, she tries to piece together the facts of her mother's death. She learned everything she could until she put everything together. It wasn't a night out anymore. It was a timeline. Her mom wasn't a person anymore. She was a story. When Stella knew everything she knew, the details weren't even all that important. It was what it meant that mattered. It meant that it was all her mother's fault. Her mother was dead, and it was all her own fault. For a long time, that was all that really mattered. Recently, CBC published a story on Tina Fontaine's death. It forefronted the information that Tina had consumed marijuana and alcohol. It barely mentioned that her slight body wrapped in a sheet was weighted down with rocks and dumped into the Red River. La Roque posits, that need of writing can best be understood as resistance literature does not mean that it is singularly political or that it lacks either complexity or grace. In the documentary, This River, which Vermette co-wrote, Vermette reinvents the enemy's language to highlight the pain that the missing loved ones have caused their families and to point out the indifference of the police in finding their loved ones. The documentary begins with an excerpt of Vermette's poetry. The screen displays the poem that gradually disappears, but for the title, This River, highlighting the disappearance of the issue from public discourse and the determination of the film's producers to render it visible. Indians drown. The family finds out. It happens every day. This land floods with dead Indians. This river swells, freezes, breaks open. Cold arms of ice welcomes Indians. The first three lines are cleverly ambiguous. The family finds out. Could mean that the family has learned of the death of their family member or that these deaths are a typical occurrence. The irony continues with the personification of a cannibalistic Indigenous people eating river, displacing agency from a dominant society that devalues and depersonalizes Indigenous people. The poem hides agency further with the clause, Indians drown, assuming that the murders of these individuals is somehow their fault. It draws attention to the problem of essentializing Indigenous people and blaming the victim for crimes often committed by perpetrators who are non-Indigenous males. Vermette, as narrator, states, we know what this river can do. So many of us are missing. Everyone knows someone who didn't come home. For a long time, many of us have believed loved ones could be found in this water. The police won't look unless they're certain someone has gone in. They say it's futile. The viewers learn that some members of the Indigenous community in the area have formed an organization called Drag the Red to locate the bodies of their missing loved ones in the Red River. Vermette's voice also counters many who have essentialized Winnipeg's North End. In her short documentary, Heart, Vermette juxtaposes the words they say and I say, to counter mainstream discourse, to reclaim the territories on which the break is set. I hear them say, oh, that North End, I know that place. But I don't think they do. This place is not just that anything. This place is home. It would be inappropriate to praise the aesthetic merits of these community-based texts without acknowledging the intergenerational trauma. Scholar Michelin talks about texts about trauma as masterpieces. If you see them only that way because of their poetic language, broken chronology, and voices, and postmodern magical realist techniques, without connecting them to the text's aim, to use traumatized and traumatizing imagery in order to tell of real trauma, to create poignant polyphony around the vortex of the disremembered and unaccounted for. A reading only on the aesthetic value would border on negationist reading. Some of the voices in The Break personify the place they refer to as The Break. Rain, Stella, and Maddie all imagine hydro towers as robots. The break symbolizes the dispossession of Métis land and their ensuing displacement. The statement, it's hydro land, was likely set aside in the days before anything was out there, is ironic as it presupposes that land is useful only if anything, meaning human construction or resource extraction, appears on it. It is also ironic that hydro is capitalized, pun intended, and personified. The disenfranchisement of immigrants and indigenous people is described as deliberate. Someone once told me that North End houses were all made cheap and big, but the lots were narrow and short. That was when you had to own a certain amount of land to vote, and all these lots were made just inches shorter. Rain points out the lack of mobility of indigenous people. In the 60s, Indians started moving in. Once status Indians could leave reserves, and many moved to the city. The lack of social capital and the inability to get work made it difficult for many of these now urban indigenous people to be autonomous. At the end of The Break, what is clear is the resiliency of the characters and the strength they gain from each other. Juno Diaz opens The Brief Water's Life of Oscar Wilde with an amazing array of intertextuality. Diaz's use of rhetorical devices, various sociolinguistic registers, and a combination of oral and literary styles from far-ranging works integrate into a seemingly three-dimensional work, a linguistic origami. Readers can close their eyes and imagine themselves eavesdropping on a corner in Washington Heights. Diaz captures the vibrancy and tension of street youth. According to Ashley Kunsa, Spanish, English, Sindarin, street slang, fiction writer Juno Diaz rocks them all, moving fluidly across languages. The sentences of Diaz's novel surge with all the complexity of immigrant, inner city, and working class experience. Diaz positions himself as a Caribbean writer by including two quotations before his novel begins. After the dedication page, Diaz then cites an excerpt from the poem The Schooner Flight by Derek Walcott, written in iambic pentameter. The speaker admits to having a sound colonial education and uses the vocative to call on the mercy of Jesus. Christ have mercy on all sleeping things. However, the they who have given Walcott Christianity and education have poisoned his soul with their carnival that has transformed his island paradise into these slums of empire. He ends with a binary opposition, either I'm nobody or a nation. Derek Walcott is both traditional and defiant while reinventing the enemy's language. He captures the informal speech of the working class Caribbean, I'm just a red nigger who loved the sea, and inserts it into a traditional English poetic form. The speaker, Shabin, in Walcott's poem is a performer, just as Junior performs his identity in Diaz's work. Walcott stated in an interview, I come from a place that likes grandeur, it likes large gestures, it is not inhibited by flourish. It is a rhetorical society. It is a society of physical performance. It is a society of style. Walcott develops an I-they binary through which he contrasts nation and colonial. Clearly, Diaz sees Walcott as an influence on his writing. Bakhtin references the Carnivalesque aspect of polyphonic voices. And Diaz embraces the form of grotesque realism wholeheartedly. The fluidity of identity construct emerges through the ever-shifting eras, locales, and ages of the characters in this intergenerational family saga. Punson notes, the novel challenges our ability to rely on familiar, comfortable categories to make sense of the characters' lives and multi-layered experiences. Diaz has described his language use in the text as idiolect, but I do not concur. Rather than idiolect, although Oscar is indeed an eccentric, his language has reached various communities, no matter how small. A fan base has developed a glossary to help with the lexicon used in the book. It is through the interstices of age, gender, class, and culture that form the audience that wants to get the language used. Diaz, through his hypersexualized narrator career, purposefully juxtaposes his street cred and geek knowledge with his fluency, with academic discourse, and privileges the former. It is through Junior's eyes that we see the trauma experienced by the three members of the De Leon family that are at the crux of the plot's trajectory. Diaz incorporates the whole Athos word family to unfold the plot. Bathos, pathos, and hath notos. Although Diaz's text is hyperbolic and carnivalesque, Diaz also underscores the impact of intergenerational trauma on a colonized people. Diaz references the portal of the Fuku as being the portal of the slave trade from Africa to the Caribbean and the Americas. Dionne Brand states in her preface to A Map of the Door of No Return, this door is not mere physicality, it is a spiritual location. It is also perhaps a psychic destination. Since leaving was never voluntary, return was and still may be an intention, however deeply buried. There is, as it says, no way in, no return. Her declaration in the beginning of her text is echoed by Lola at the end of Diaz's novel. But if these years have taught me anything, it is this. You can never run away, not ever. The only way out is in. Colonialism is the disease, the Foucault, and self-representation through counter-narrative is the cure. In her article, Myth, Policy, and Health, Pepescu states, Canada's Indian policies constitute a form of psychological terrorism, which has had a profound health effect on the health of its indigenous victims. She later states colonialism is a disease that leads to post-colonial stress response. Junior states of the story he has narrated, even now as I write these words, I wonder if this book ain't a Zaffa of sorts, my very own counterspell. Story indeed has the power to heal, and no more so than a story of a community overcoming tragedy. What if what happens to one happens to all? What if the story of a truck hitting a bus of young athletes and killing them impacted so many that the ripple effects were worldwide? What if?